Good morning and welcome to worship at the Jasper United Methodist Church. It is good to see everyone and good to be together on this Sunday morning. Let me share with you a few things going on in and around the church. First, let me remind you to like us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and don't forget to hit that notification bell. A lot of things on the back of the bulletin this morning. That means there's a lot of things going on. So I'm just going to highlight some of those, call your attention to notice the things there and find a place to be involved in the ministry. It is Ledford Scholarship time for our graduating high school seniors. So for those high school seniors who have been part of and connected to this church, we want to encourage you to make sure that you get that form filled out before May 3rd. You can come by the church office or you can do it online as well. We're going to be having safe sanctuary training. This is training to just ensure that we do all we can to take the best care of our children and our youth. And so we want to encourage folks to come and be a part of this training, just so we as a church are on the same page. This is something that's been, if you read the newsletter in the front, this is something that's been in place since 1996 in the United Methodist Church. But it's been a number of years since we have done a training here at the Jasper United Methodist Church. So we encourage you to come and join us on May 5th at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. That's on Sunday afternoon. Hopefully you have time to go get lunch and come back. And we have someone coming from the conference office to come and do this training for us. And look forward to having folks here. If you have questions about it, you can reach out to Anna Faith. She can answer those questions for you. But we really would love for you to come and join us, and we can all be together on doing the best job we can to do ministry in our church. Our KOK musical, they're sitting up here in front of us, or behind me today, in front of you, behind me this morning. They're going to be sharing in music this morning, but their musical Storms will be presented on Mother's Day, and they will be collecting flood bucket items during their time of worship. And so there's a list in your bulletin today of what those items are, and we just encourage you to bring those with you. Kathy, please correct me if I'm wrong, but to bring those with you on Sunday morning, and the children are going to come out. They're going to be picking those up during the musical, as a part of worship, as an opportunity of giving in the midst of worship. Let's put it that way. So we hope that you'll support them and bring something with you that Sunday morning. Jasper United Methodist Preschool is registering for the 24-25 school year. I want to encourage folks, if you have a child of that age, that you'll get them registered and come join us. You can do that online, or you can pick up forms at the preschool or the church office. Been speaking a lot about Vacation Bible School. It's coming up. It's in June 18th, 19th, and 20th. You're going to continue to hear me speak of it because I think it's important. I think it's a wonderful event that we have here, and I want to encourage you that if you can, just give one day, one morning, to come and be a part of that week. I'm almost willing to say to you that if you come one day, you'll be back the next. It's just that enjoyable in spending time with children in our community. So I encourage you to reach out to Anna Faith and let her know that you'll come and serve sometime during that week. We're getting ready for the church picnic. It usually takes place in June. It's going to be June 19th. You'll see information there. It's going to be here on our property. We're going to meet here this year for our picnic, so be looking for more information about that as the time gets closer. Our April CARES donations, cleaning supplies such as disinfectant wipes, window cleaners, sponges, paper towels, etc. If you bring those CARES items each week, we make sure they get to CARES to help folks out in our community. The youth choir will have a parents meeting for the summer music tour, and it will be at 4:45 on Sunday, May 5th. There's information about that in your bulletin. I'm just going to share with you the date and time, 4:45 on Sunday, May 5th. And also an opportunity for something taking place in our community. Please see the information in the bulletin about the Arts Alliance and an event that's going to take place on April the 27th. So please take note of that and be aware of that opportunity here in our community. Other things going on in and around the church, all kinds of stuff happening. I encourage you to take your bulletin home, look through your calendar, see where you can be involved in the events that are taking place in and around the church. As we gather as God's people and prepare for our opening hymn this morning, As we share in our opening hymn, you can bring your gift of tithe and offering, place it in the offering plates that are here on the altar rail this morning, or you can place them in the usher on the in the tithe and offering box that is on the usher's table in the back of the sanctuary. And speaking of that, next Sunday, immediately following worship, for those who are willing and interested, we're going to do an usher training to go back to passing the plates on Sunday morning during this worship service. So if you're willing to be one of those folks and you can stay next Sunday, it won't take long, just a little quick overview of what we're going to do and our thoughts are. And so encourage you, if you can do that, to do that, and we'll plan to meet next Sunday following worship. But as we gather for worship this morning, as we prepare to share in our opening hymn, I want to invite you to stand as you're able, share greetings with one another of hellos and giving peace of God, and then we will share in our opening hymn. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good.
Yeah.
That's right here.
Thanks to God for our gift of tithe and offering. Following that, we'll share together in our doxology. Let us pray. Gracious and almighty God, for the beauty of who you are, for the beauty of the blessings of life, we are truly, truly thankful. Lord, we ask your blessings now upon our gift of tithe and offering. Lord, we ask that you would bless them and send them into the world, that others will come to know the beauty that you add to life, the gift of salvation, and so much more. Lord, we ask this in your gracious and holy name this day. Amen. Too far away from you. I don't know about you, but it sure was good to see those little faces this morning. It was good to hear their voices this morning. What a blessing. Gives you just a preview, a little touch of Mother's Day. So make sure that's on your calendar. Come and be a part of that wonderful morning of service. This morning, as we spend some time in prayer, I want us to contemplate shepherds. If you've looked at the bulletin, you've noticed that our title is Jesus Our Shepherd? So shepherds. And shepherds are mentioned in Scripture, in the Bible, often. But what do they mean? What does it mean when we hear that word? How do we connect with it and what it means in our life as a follower of Jesus? So this morning we're going to spend a little time thinking and sharing in that thought process. So I know you also have come in this morning with things on your heart and mind. And I invite you to take all of those things this morning as well as we share time together. Let's pray together. Gracious, loving, and almighty God, we come into your presence on this Sunday morning. And Lord, a Sunday morning when it's raining, it's cloudy, the sun's not shining through the clouds. Lord, it's difficult. It's hard. So, Lord, we ask this morning that you would help us to see the Son in your love and grace this morning. That you would help us to experience your presence to brighten this day. That we can experience your hope and your peace, your joy and your love. That regardless of the clouds and the rain, we know that you are present with us. Lord, as we come this morning, we are considering shepherds. And how does that connect with who we are as a follower of Jesus today? Lord, we ask that you would help us to consider that in our lives. How does it connect with who we are as a follower of Jesus? Gracious God, we come also this morning with concerns for people in our lives. For folks we care about who are going through some difficulties and some struggles. And Lord, we ask that they would know you are present, that they would feel your presence, and that they would know you're there, that you are bringing into their lives hope, peace, comfort in those times when comfort is needed, strength and encouragement in the midst of the day-to-day, and assurance that you are always with us. Lord, in the midst of all of this, we pray that you are known, that you are felt, you are experienced in people's lives. And Lord, we come with our own stuff. We come with our own ailments. We come with our own issues. We come with our own struggles. And Lord, we pray that we feel your presence as well. We know that you are with us no matter what the situation might be. Lord, help us to feel and know that presence so that we may be an example to everyone else of living a life in relationship with you that leads and guides us. Now, gracious God, we ask your blessings to be upon us as we continue in this time of worship. Open our hearts and minds. Help us to experience your grace, your love, your mercy, that we may leave here better able to be your people, your disciples, a sheep in the fold of God himself. For this we pray in your gracious and holy name, as we pray together the prayer that your Son taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Sin defend us.
I was expecting to do the final hymn. I didn't know I was leaving this one. So that one kind of jumped up on me. This morning, our scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of John. In the 10th chapter, beginning with verse 11 and reading through verse 18. The Gospel of John, in the 10th chapter, beginning with verse 11, reading through verse 18. I'm reading from the Common English Bible. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. When the hired hand sees the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. That's because he isn't the shepherd. The sheep aren't really his. So the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. He's only a hired hand, and the sheep don't matter to him. I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. I give up my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that don't belong to this sheep pen. I must lead them too. They will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock with one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me. I give up my life so that I can take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I give it up because I want to. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it up again. I receive this commandment from my Father. We give thanks to God for the reading and the hearing of these words found in the Gospel of John this day as we pray. Gracious and almighty God, as we consider the words found here in the Gospel of John, open our hearts and minds. Help us to experience your presence. Help us to know that you are with us. And help us to leave better able to be your disciples. For this we pray in your gracious and holy name. Amen. Last week we shared about witnessing. We shared about experiencing God and then sharing that with other people. Today, we're going to consider what it is that we are witnesses of or witness to. Today, we're thinking and seeing and speaking of Jesus found in Gospel of John in the 10th chapter. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I am the good shepherd. Shepherds. Now, shepherds have a very different meaning in the time of Scripture than they do necessarily in the world today. It's a very different process of raising animals in the world today than it was at the time this was written. Shepherds are spoken of in Scripture in more than one place. Shepherds had a very important part to play in the Jewish life. Sheep were very important in the Jewish culture. Sheep provided wool. Wool became fabrics. Fabrics became clothing and other items that were needed for life. Sheep also served as a food source for the people of Israel. And lambs served in the sacrificial needs of their religious life. So you see, sheep had a very special place in their culture. Therefore, shepherds were necessary and they were needed. Now, sheep held an important place in society, and they were to be, even though they were a commodity, they were important commodity, and they had special meaning. So the sheep being taken care of was very important. So the shepherd had a big job. And the shepherd saw his sheep not just as a commodity, but as something that was necessary for life in the Jewish community. Now, even though that's true, shepherds were not considered royalty. Shepherds were not very wealthy. And shepherds were not invited to people's houses for lunch. You see, shepherds lived with the sheep. And what happens when you live with sheep? You smell like sheep. So, shepherds were not always seen as clean. They'd have to go through particular kind of cleansing rituals for religious services because of what they did. But what they did was important. So even though people appreciated the shepherd, they didn't go out and invite him to their house. But shepherds were important in keeping watch over the sheep. Now, an important thing to know about shepherds, and it's alluded to in our scripture today, that is that the shepherd knew their sheep, and the sheep know the shepherd. Now, that's an important thing to remember, because Jesus paints us this picture. Paints us the picture of the difference between the shepherd, the owner of the sheep, the one who looks after and takes care of, and a person that he just hires to help him out. A person that he hires, a hired hand, maybe the shepherd's got to go to the doctor. Somebody's got to look after the sheep while the shepherd goes to see the doctor, right? Now, I don't know if they went to see doctors back then. I have no idea. But we can relate to what that means, right? A necessity to be away from the sheep. Let's do something a little more simple. Maybe he had to go to his child's birthday party, okay? But he needed somebody to look after, so he'd hire somebody to look after the sheep. And Jesus is making the distinction that the hired hand, when the wolf is seen at a distance, the hired hand doesn't wait around to see if the wolf is actually coming their direction or not. He's gone because he has no connection to the sheep. They're not his. He was hired to look after them. And he's not willing, or he's not getting paid enough to put his life on the line for those sheep. But Jesus said the shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Lays down his life for the sheep. That a shepherd will go against the wolf and stand against the wolf and stand against the lion to keep them out and away from the sheep. Why? Because the shepherd knows the importance of the sheep. The shepherd knows the importance to the community, to their way of living, their culture. Not only that, the sheep are his. He knows his sheep, and the sheep know the shepherd. When I was 17 years old, I was given a gift of a Cocker Spaniel puppy. Now, I had had a dog before. As a matter of fact, I understand from my mother right after I was born, my grandfather brought a puppy to the house. Isn't that what everybody wants? You got a new baby? Now you got a puppy. But my grandfather evidently brought a puppy to the house. It was a little mixed breed dog. Her name was Honey. And I grew up with that dog. She lived 16 years. So I was 16 years old when she passed away. So that was the only pet I really ever knew. There was a few cats that came and go, you know, as cats come and go. You know, in people's lives, especially those that live outside. But Honey, even though she was an outside dog, she never left. And I had a lot of adventures in 16 years with that little dog. But here I am, 17 years old, and someone gives me a Cocker Spaniel puppy. Now, it wasn't my parents. So my parents, who did not want another dog in the house or around the house, right? A friend gave me this dog as a gift on my 17th birthday. So I was old enough to take care of this myself. So Jenny, her name was Jenny, Jenny slept in a box beside my bed. And there were many a night that Jenny, a puppy all alone, began to whine. And I'd roll over to the side of the bed and I'd stick my hand down in that box. And she'd quieten down. She'd come, feel the warmth of my hand. I was able to go back to sleep. She finally went back to sleep. And for months, that was our relationship in the evenings or for nighttime. And then we spent all kinds of time together throughout the day. Jenny knew me, and I knew Jenny. When I went off to college, my dad would complain that Jenny, by this point, had a pen in the backyard, pretty nice sized pen, fenced in area, doghouse, the whole nine yards, you know. And my dad would complain that when I would come home, the dog knew the sound of my vehicle and was at the gate waiting for me to come and say hello. My dad would say, "I'm the one who feeds her. Why is it that she looks so forward to you coming home?" Because I knew Jenny, and Jenny knew me. That's the closest thing I can come to relating the understanding of the shepherd knowing the sheep. And knowing the sheep so well. And the sheep learning to trust the shepherd. I always tell this story, many of you have heard this story, that helps me even more understand that relationship. And that is the story about the sheep gate. The sheep gate. Someone shared this story with me from a trip to the Holy Land, and their guide shared with them this story from the ancient times of shepherds. When a shepherd had the sheep out grazing, you know, in an area, when night began to fall, they had to find a safe place to get in away from predators. Now, those places, depending on where they were at. So it might be a ring of a, like a fence that was made out of stone, just rocks stacked on top of each other. They would have a small opening on one side in one area. Okay? Or it might be a cave on the side of a mountain where they would take the sheep into. It might be a hole dug down into the ground so the sheep would be safe. Whatever it was, and wherever the shepherd happened to be, they would go to the opening. They would stand with their legs spread apart, and the sheep would enter into that place for the night. Now, as the sheep entered and went through his legs, he would start at their nose with his hands and go all the way to their hooves. And he was checking the sheep for all kinds of things. He was checking to make sure that places that he had been putting medicine on for healing were healing right. He was checking to see if there were any new sores that needed attention. He was checking for rocks and twigs and other things, bugs that might have got caught in the wool as they were grazing during the day. He was checking also to make sure it was his sheep. You see, he knew his sheep by the way they felt. You know that scripture that says that God knows every hair on our head? The shepherd knew his sheep. He knew them that well. He knew how their wool felt. He knew every bump, every bruise, every scar that his sheep had. Now, once he had counted for all of his sheep and they were in that safe place, The shepherd laid down across the opening. You see, as I told the preschoolers this week when I talked about shepherds with them, there was no door like the classroom. It was just an opening. No gate. Side of a mountain cave does not have a gate. Doesn't have a door. There was no gate. There was no door. The shepherd lay down across the opening. He was the gate. He laid down across the opening so that if anything came in, anything wanted to come in and bother the sheep, they had to climb over him. Therefore, he would wake up and defend the sheep from the lions and the tigers and the bears or whatever might have been roaming as a predator at that point in time in that particular place. You see, the shepherd knows the sheep. The sheep know the shepherd. The shepherd cares for the sheep, willing to lay down his very life to protect the sheep. That's a shepherd. Do we know the good shepherd? Are we a sheep in the fold of the good shepherd? Shepherds. Probably one of the best known piece of scripture about shepherds was written by David. Now, David became king. He was King David. But before David was a king, he was a shepherd. He took care of his father's sheep. And he wrote these words to talk about the very heart of God. I'm going to read the 23rd Psalm for you from the King James Version because most of us know it by those words. And often when I don't, my tongue doesn't want to say the words right. But David wrote these words to give us a glimpse of the very heart of God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If this is a glimpse of the heart of God, why would we not want to be a sheep in the fold of the Good Shepherd? Interesting thing about the 23rd Psalm. In the 5th verse, the line is, "Thou anointest my head with oil." Now, I say this often when I share the 23rd Psalm. I always thought that was a religious ritual. In the Jewish religion, in the Christian religion, we often anoint with oils for healing, for blessings, those kinds of things. But I learned that shepherds had a particular oil, mixture of different things, that they would put over the eyes on the forehead of the sheep. And it had a purpose. It was to keep the bugs away from the sheep's eyes. Can you imagine the annoyance? You know how annoyed you get when a bug... If you don't, come with us to Terrytown in the summertime. We'll introduce you to the gnats of South Georgia. Well, whatever the bugs were, of course, they could cause problems. They could cause infections and issues like that. So the ointment, the oil, was to keep the bugs out of the sheep's eyes. And I always come to this piece and remind us that for me, That reminds me that God is even interested in the most annoying things, you know, the little annoyances of life, like bugs that get in your ears and in your eyes. God is even concerned about those things in our life. Our text from the Gospel of John today was words of Jesus telling us that he was and is the good shepherd. Are we sheep of the good shepherd? Are we sheep in the good shepherd's fold? This morning, I think we need to contemplate that this morning. Do you feel the presence of Jesus in your life, caring for you and looking after you and being with you, and the same kind of understanding of a relationship between a shepherd of this day, of this time, biblical time, and the sheep? If not, I want to encourage us this morning. I want to encourage you to take hold of that truth. To take hold of the truth that you are that important in the eyes of God. That you are cared for that deeply. Now there is responsibility on our side. You see, we got to be willing to know the Good Shepherd that well also. We got to be willing to know the Good Shepherd that well so that we trust Him and we follow Him. We listen for His still small voice in our life. And we seek His guidance from day to day. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep and they know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I give up my life for the sheep. 23rd Psalm, words from a common English Bible translation. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He lets me rest in grassy meadows. He leads me to restful waters. He keeps me alive. He guides me in proper paths for the sake of His good name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no danger because You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they protect me. You set a table for me right in front of my enemies. You bathe my head in oil. My cup is so full it spills over. Yes, goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the Lord's house as long as I live. Are we sheep of the Good Shepherd? If you're wondering this morning if that's true in your life, I want to encourage you to spend some time this week, maybe with the 23rd Psalm, maybe with this verse from John chapter 10. Spend some time with these and experience the love, the compassion, the care of a shepherd who is willing to lay his life down for you. His sheep. If you're living in the midst of that kind of relationship, give thanks to God for it. Celebrate it every day and live in the beauty of it. There's something about the illustration, the analogy, the whatever you want to call it, of a shepherd and the good shepherd The Good Shepherd makes it a whole lot easier for me to consider myself a sheep in the fold of God Himself. Let us pray. Gracious, loving, and almighty God, we come now into your presence on this Sunday morning. And Lord, we are thankful. We are thankful for the words from the Gospel of John, for the words of the 23rd Psalm. Lord, we are thankful that you are the Good Shepherd. Lord, we pray that you will help us be good sheep. Help us to follow you. Help us to pay attention to you. Help us to strive to get to know you even more, to see you as valuable in our lives, knowing that we are valued in yours. For Lord, you paid the ultimate price. Help us to experience that in our life and to celebrate what it means to be a sheep in the fold of God. For this we pray this day in your gracious and holy name. Amen. As we prepare to share together in our closing hymn this morning, it is always a privilege to remind us that the altar is open and available for any who would come and spend time humbly on your knees in God's presence. Maybe this morning you do want to come and just give thanks to God. Just give thanks to God for the relationship of the Good Shepherd. Maybe this morning you're thinking, I'm not sure I've got that, Greg. I want to encourage you to come and start that conversation with God. That you want that to be stronger. You want that relationship, that connection to be stronger so that there is no doubt that you're a sheep of the Good Shepherd. Because the Good Shepherd wants you. He wants you in his fold. He wants to pour hope, peace, joy, and love into your life. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Start that conversation with God. That you want that kind of relationship. As we share together. I know there's other things on your heart and mind, and you came in here with them this morning. If you feel you need to come to the altar and share those needs and things with God this morning, then don't hesitate. You can do it where you're at. You can do it where you're seated. You can do it where you're standing when we sing our hymn. But for me, there's something about this place in a church. Always has been. So I encourage you. Have those conversations with God as we share together in our closing hymn this morning. Let me invite you to stand as you're able, and let's share together in a charge of keep I have.
Help me to watch and pray.
Before I share the benediction today, I want to share some news with you. I was going to have Lydia come and stand with me, but she's in the booth observing today. So I want to share with you this morning that we are coming to an end of 9 years together. We're coming to an end of 9 years together. I got my letter this week, and I'm going to get to start number 10, which makes us, Lydia and I, very happy that we will be together for a 10th year with you here in Jasper. Nine years is the longest you've ever had one pastor. It's the longest I've been in one church. So we get to start new in July on year number 10, which is also a new for you and for me. So we will begin to pray now as we end this ninth year together and we look forward to year number 10, that God will be at the center of who we are in all of its beauty and of all of the God's ability. So I am very thankful to finally know. I'm going to tell y'all, doing what Lydia and I do is so different. So different. Because the choice and the decision is not up to us. I'm asked what I would like to do. You are asked, your SPR, your Staff Parish Relations Committee, are asked what the church's wishes are. But ultimately, our bishop and cabinet make these decisions for the betterment of the church. And so the waiting is always the hardest part for us because it's just uncertainty until the letter is emailed now or the phone call is made. And so it was exciting last Sunday, actually afternoon, I actually received the letter in the email to let me know. And last Sunday was announcement day for all those who were moving. So there are lots of moves that are taking place in July. A lot of my colleagues are still sitting in uncertain places with certain things. And there's a lot of things that are going on. This week begins General Conference. General Conference begins the 23rd of April and runs through the 3rd of May. I want to share with you, as I did in the newsletter, in case you have forgotten that or you didn't read it, please, if you hear something in the news about General Conference, call me. Let's talk about it. The news sources do not know how the United Methodist Church does things. They just don't. Unless we get fortunate and a really good United Methodist news person is doing the story. Okay? But as I put in the newsletter, there's a couple of places that you can go and see information about General Conference every day. The first week of General Conference is mostly committee meetings, where they look at all the resolutions that are presented in different groups. And then the next week is when those things get presented to the whole body. To remind you, General Conference is not just English-speaking people. United Methodist Church is a worldwide denomination, which means there are 2,000 to 3,000 people in Charlotte, North Carolina, coming in this week from all over the world. Africa, Asia, Europe. Just be aware of that. They don't all speak English. So General Conference is a big ordeal, and it takes a lot of people to make it happen. And just lean into the Good Shepherd when things come on the news station or you get your Atlanta Journal and you read an article about what's going on at General Conference in the United Methodist Church and it makes you upset, call me, because it may not all be exactly the way they put it because they don't understand how we do things. So just be aware of that. in the week that is, a couple of weeks that have come, and strive to be who God calls us to be in the midst of it all. So with our eyes to heaven, hear these words of benediction. As we leave this place, may we experience all the beauty that God has in store for us in the week ahead. May we know the saving grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, that changes our hearts and minds every single day. And may the Holy Spirit inspire us. Inspire us to be a sheep in the fold of the Good Shepherd, living our lives following His guidance, His encouragement, His love and His grace, both now and forevermore. Amen? Amen. Go in God's peace.